So let's apply the ideas we discussed earlier in a specific problem that is referred to as weighted interval scheduling problem. You have seen a variation of this problem in the part about greedy algorithms, but in that case we didn't have weights. So we have a number of jobs, n of them, and for each job we have the start time, the finish time. In this case we also have a weight. And we like jobs with larger weight. Think of the weight as a value of the job. Now again, two jobs are compatible only if they don't overlap in time, because the idea is that we have only one machine, one server, and that server can execute only one job at a time. So in this case, we do not try to find the maximum number of jobs that we can schedule. We're trying to find the subset of the jobs that give us, that will give us the maximum total weight. So these jobs, of course, they still have to be mutually compatible. So if I pick, for instance, job A, the only other compatible jobs would be either G or H. Let's say that I pick A and G. In that case, the weight that I would get from this subset is the weight of A, which is VA, plus the weight of G, which is VG. Of course, you can make other choices. Let's introduce some notation here that will make it easy to talk about which jobs are compatible with a given job J. So suppose we have already sorted the jobs based on finish time, and we have labeled them based on finish time. So the first job has the lowest finish time, job 1, and the last job has the last finish time. Now, what do we mean by PJ? PJ, J again is a job, is the largest index of a job that is compatible with J. So for instance, what is P of the job of job 6? 5 is not compatible with 6, 4 is not compatible with 6, 3 is not compatible with 6, but 2 is compatible with 6. So this is the largest job index that is still compatible with job 6. Now, how can you compute these values P efficiently? We also sort the starting times of the jobs. Then we can go through time, going through the sequence of starting times. And whenever we have the starting time of a certain job J, we can ask, what was the last finish time that we have seen before SJ? So if the last finish time, for instance, was FK, then P of J will be K. If there was no job finishing before job J starts, then by convention, we define that P of J is 0. So if we have sorted both the finish times and the start times, we can compute these values P in linear time. So now that we have the appropriate notation, we are ready to set up our dynamic program. Again, remember, we have to figure out which are the subproblems, and second, what is the recurrence equation that we can use to compute the solution of a subproblem from solutions of smaller subproblems. It's reasonable to think about a subproblem instead of having n jobs. We have only J jobs, where J is smaller or equal than N. So we can use this variable J to determine the size of the subproblem that we are considering. Remember that the jobs are sorted based on finish time. So by taking only the, by considering only the jobs from 1 to J, we're considering essentially only the first J jobs in terms of finish time. So let's define the optimal solution of this subproblem, the subproblem that goes all the way from 1 to J, as OPT, optimum J. If you think about it, there are only two cases we need to consider. One case is that this specific job J is actually part of this solution, and the other case is that it's not part of the solution. If the job J is in that optimal solution of this subproblem, then we can say that the optimal solution of that subproblem is the value of job J, this is J, right, plus whatever optimal solution we have for a smaller subproblem that includes all of the jobs 1, 2, all the way to pj. Remember, this is the maximum index of a job that is compatible with j. So if we have already committed that job j is in the optimal solution, then we cannot, of course, consider any jobs that are not compatible with j. That's why we are only considering the jobs in that case from 1 through pj. If, on the other hand, job J is not in the optimal solution of this subproblem all the way to J, then, of course, we do not include the value of that job in the optimal solution, and instead we say that the optimal solution of the subproblem that includes the first J jobs is the same with the optimal solution of the subproblem that includes the first J minus 1 jobs. How would you choose between this case and that case? How would you choose whether job J will actually be in the optimal solution of this subproblem? Well, it simply depends on which of these two quantities is larger, right? So I can pick either this. This corresponds to the case that job J is in the optimal solution of this subproblem, or I can pick the optimal solution of this subproblem that doesn't include job J. I will choose between this or that depending on which is larger, right? Because I like to have the maximum total value. So this is the recurrence equation I was talking about before. As you see, it expresses the solution of a subproblem based on solutions, optimal solutions, of smaller subproblems. Both this one and this one are smaller subproblems. They have to do with a smaller value of J. Now, of course, we also need a base case. So you can define that the optimal solution, if I have zero jobs, is zero, because there is no value in that case. So let's turn now the previous recurrence into a code. So this is the recurrence equation we had before, and the algorithm looks like this. We have as input the number of jobs, the start times, the finish times, and the values of the jobs. Now, you have to sort the jobs by finish times, as we discussed before. And in order to compute these p values we discussed earlier, you have to also sort based on starting times. Now, the actual iteration happens here. You have the base case, right? If you don't have any jobs, the optimal solution is zero. And then you have a for loop that goes through the jobs, it goes through the subproblems really from 1 to n. And in each iteration, you pick either this or that, depending on which one is larger. If this one is larger, then you set the optimal solution of the subproblem J equal to this part here. And you output J. Why do you do that? You do that so that you know which are the jobs. Right, so at this point you want to record that the job J is actually part of the optimal solution. Else you don't output anything, and you just set that the optimal solution of this problem is equal to the optimal solution of the previous subproblem. Notice here that we have an iteration. It's not a recursive algorithm. Dynamic programs are not recursive. We're moving from problems of smaller size towards problems of larger size. So the algorithm is essentially building the solution in a bottom-up manner. In terms of running time, notice that the algorithm is big O and log n, because you need to sort the jobs, both based on finish time and start time. If you have done that, then you can compute the p-values as we discussed in linear time using the sorted start time and finish times. The iteration I previously showed you, each iteration takes constant time and you need to repeat the iteration n times. So overall, the algorithm considering this sorting takes big O and log n. If you are given the jobs with pre-sorted start and finish times, then of course it would only be big O n. Now, in terms of the DAG that I was talking about before, essentially in this case, the solution of the problem, the subproblem J, all the jobs up to J, depends on two subproblems of smaller size. Either the subproblem of this size, J minus 1, or the subproblem of the first PJ jobs. The solution of every subproblem depends on two previous subproblems, two smaller subproblems, until of course we reach the base case. In that case, you don't depend on any previous subproblems. It is useful to contrast the approach of dynamic programming with the approach of recursion or divide and conquer. So let's think about the same problem, but this time writing the code so that we use divide and conquer. So again, we have the same inputs. Again, we sort the jobs based on finish time. We compute the p-values. All of these things are the same as before. But now we have this recursive function, compute OPT, which we initially call on the full set of jobs. So initially we will call it like that. And this function, of course, if the input argument is 0, it returns 0. Otherwise, it will use recursion here to compute the solution of both the subproblem PJ and the subproblem J minus 1, recursively, as you see. The problem is, as you can imagine, that we are computing the solution of certain subproblems more than once. We are doing redundant work. This can be shown in the most extreme instance with this type of jobs, where every job overlaps with the previous job, but not with the job before. So for any job J, P of J is J minus 2. So for that specific case, as you can see, if say we want to compute the optimal solution for 5 jobs, we need to compute both the optimal solution for 4 jobs, this is this part of the recursion, and we need to compute the optimal solution for job 3, which is this part of the recursion. And the same thing happens at every level of the recursion tree. So for job 4, you need to compute both the optimal solution of the subproblem 3 as well as the subproblem 2. What you see in this recursion tree is that the same problem, say problem 2, is actually solved multiple times. Similarly, the problem 3 has to be solved multiple times. You could see that the number of problems that we have to solve increases exponentially with the size of the jobs n. So is this really the end of the story for this recursive approach? Or is there a way that we can actually make recursion work without having to solve all of these redundant problems? We can rely on an approach called memoization, which basically stores the results of subproblems that we have already solved so that we don't need to solve them again. Right? So we trade off space for computation time. we will have an array here, let's call it M, in which we store the solutions of subproblems that we previously solved. So initially this array, we somehow mark every entry as empty, so that we know that we haven't really solved that problem yet. And we have the same type of recursive function as you saw in the previous page. The only difference is that we are computing the solution to the J subproblem only if we have not done that yet, right? If we have already computed that the solution to that subproblem, the function just returns without doing anything. This very simple approach guarantees that we solve every subproblem only once. And in that case, the running time of this recursive approach is no different than the running time of the dynamic programming approach.